This week, this month rather, we've got Martine Dowden. She's going to be talking. She got her wonderful. Say hello.
Hi.
There she is. Now you can see her on the screen because she talked. You know, Zoom. You got the Zoom aggro now. It'll show you. She's got a talk tonight. Typesetting in CSS using typography to enhance your design, which is not JavaScript, obviously, but it's very much JavaScript adjacent. And I think it's an important topic for those who are building front end type stuff to care about this. You should care about these things. So, so that's what we have tonight. Just a quick guideline. If you've got any questions, just drop them in chat. If you're on Twitch, I'll be monitoring Twitch chat. And if you are on here in the Zoom with us, then go ahead and just unmute yourself and ask, or drop in the chat there, and I'll make sure Martine hears them. And if you're watching on Twitch, feel free to join. The Zoom link is in the meetup, so join us there. And if you're watching later on YouTube, then thanks for watching. Leave a question in the comments below. I think that covers everyone, right? Okay. So, well, in that case, Martine, welcome. And the floor is yours.
Well, hello, everyone. So like I said, we're going to talk about typography today because so much of our, if we look at our applications in general, so much of our applications are text. Like what percentage of it is graphics versus text? And so much of it, you can do so much with that. We tend to kind of forget about it and forget and, you know, focus on our animations and focus on our you know, pretty pictures and those sorts of things. But there's a lot to be said about playing with the text itself and how to make that pretty. And so what today we're going to do is we're going to look at what are the things we can do with just CSS, because it does have a much wider range than the simple, you know, font weight, font and font size and color that we usually use. There's a lot more to it and there's a lot more we can do with it. So that's what we're going to explore today. So I'm Martine Dowden. I'm currently the CTO of Andromeda, where we do our own personal projects as well as consulting, mostly focusing on project development and MVP, like creating MVPs and products from the ground up, as well as accessibility. So let's go back to the very beginning of what text actually is. If we think back to the very beginning of time and of recorded history, and I use recorded history loosely, we have the Lascaux cave paintings, and actually recently they just discovered some more cave paintings, which is really cool. I'm looking forward to them publishing all the pics. But the since the dawn of time, humans have tried to record their experiences and communicate in some kind of written fashion. Obviously, different times meant different mediums, anywhere from obviously carvings to writing. And I'm skipping through this very, very quickly because I want to get to the meat of the CSS. I understand that I'm skipping vast swashes of history here and in not representing every culture and every form of writing. I just wanted to give a vast overview to show that text is really nothing new. And so we kind of see the development of alphabets and of way of writing and how, as we progress over time, if we look at the original Lascaux paintings, it's very pictographic. There's not a whole lot of, there's some nuance, but it's not really like, you can tell a story, but you're not writing out something. And then you move over to the Greeks and the Phoenician, and now you really have writing per se. And so a lot of it was built in order to build efficiency and in order to write very, very quickly. For example, the Phoenicians and later the Greeks really streamlined their process because they wanted to be able to do transactions and record transactions. It was for business. So I thought that was really interesting. We move forward and we see a shift in how that writing is done, where we have the manuscripts, the monks and, you know, in their monasteries painfully and stakingly recording everything and copying everything. So to get something printed in print form, there was very, very limited access. And then came the printing press, which really gave that written word and that written content the ability to be distributed very, very widely. And so we saw, as we have the printing press and then eventually the web, we see a decrease in the flourishment of that typography. We see it more and more being used for purpose rather than pretty. But there is a lot of things we can do to go ahead and make that and give it some flair, even though obviously if you're going to be illuminating something, doing that on the web is not exactly something you would do on the day in and day out website. But we can give it some flourish. And a lot of the terms and a lot of the concepts that we'll see in the CSS actually come back to either terminology that was developed in the printing press days, or even before in the manuscripts and the terminology that was built around handwriting. A lot of the fonts we see today are also have their history back into what was before for the printing press. So typography, what does actual typography means? It comes from the Greek typos, meaning impression, and the Latin graphia. So we're going to mix Greek and Latin, because of course we can. And so basically it means the art of designing with type or typography. So how do we achieve that on the web? Well, the first thing we're going to look at is our typefaces. Our typefaces is in the common vernacular, we usually say font, but essentially font is a lot more specific. Typeface is the actual family of fonts for a specific alphabet. And so depending, before they were blocks of metal, sometimes lead, and now we obviously have the digital versions, some of which those pieces actually still exist. There's several museums that have them. They're really cool to look at. But the first piece that we need to choose when we're thinking about the text on a website is what kind of typeface do we want to use? This particular one is Montserrat underneath this railway. There's hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of them. One that if you're in the United States, that you probably heard at some point in high school or college is Times New Roman, 12-point font, you know, double-spaced. In this particular case, the typeface would be Times New Roman. Generally, in CSS, you're going to refer to that as your font family. When you're picking a particular font family or typeface, we look at the individual letters, and that's going to kind of tell us what type of typeface it's going to be. And there's several classifications. And the letters that we want to look at when we're kind of trying to differentiate between several typefaces to choose, your best bet are going to be capital RTW and lowercase HAENG. And the reason why is because generally speaking, in terms of differentiating between alphabets, those are going to be your letters that vary the most. And they're very good judges of being able to look at, they're going to be the ones with the little bit of extra, the little bit of, if you think of the W, for example, whether it's crisscrossed as an in railway or not versus in forum, which are displayed here on the screen on the bottom. The other piece you're going to want to look at is whether it is serifed or sans serifed. So at the very beginning, you have the word alphabet. At the very top, the alpha is written in a serif font and the bet is written in a sans serif font. And that has to do with the little bits at the bottom. The other piece that we have outside of serifed and sans serif is display and monospace. So displays are going to be, they're not going to be as legible. They're your fancy, fancy ones. So if you think of papyrus as a pretty well-known one, that's going to be a display font. They're generally things that are going to be really cool in some way, really fun in some way, but they're definitely not things you're going to want to use for large bodies of text because of their legibility. Monospace, that's one that as a developer, we see every day. That's usually what we're using in our code editor. And it's called monospace because each letter takes up the exact same amount of space versus in serif, sans serif, and display, each letter might be wider or narrower. So you're not going to get as much of a gap around your I, for example, as you would get in the monospace, because the I in monospace would take up the same amount of room as a W, which would allow us to line up our type really well. So for screens, It's been they've done some research in terms of what's more legible. And when they look at legible, what scientists look at is how fast can you read it? How well can you understand what you're looking at and the content that you're reading, and how much of it can you retain? So that's generally things that are considered when looking at research around legibility. And it's generally gonna be one or more of a combination of those three things that is gonna be looked at. Oh, and how accurate are you at reading it? But it's gonna be those are the things that are looked at. And what they found is that the nature of the type has very little to do with how readable it is. What they found is what you're used to seeing is how readable, will help determine whether you find something legible or not. Well, historically speaking, we've seen serif font in print and sans serif font on the screen. So what's happened is in a lot of the Western world, serif font, if you're doing something to be printed, then a serif font is going to be more legible. If you're doing something to be read on the screen, then a sans serif font is going to be more legible. So for website purposes, generally speaking, you're going to want to pick for your large bodies of text a sans serif font. So those are going to be, in this case, you have Lado, or some of the more common ones are Helvetica, Roboto, which Material uses. All of those are the Verdana. All of those are sans serif fonts. In terms of what is considered web safe, or that is generally going to be available for you as a typeface, there's very little of them. There's Georgia, Times New Roman, Arial, Trebuchet, Verdana, and Courier New. That's it. Anything outside of those, it's dependent upon OS, it's dependent upon a person's system or setup. So more than likely, you're going to be importing that font. Or that typeface. But all of them are, so where do we import them from? There's a couple ways we can do that. My favorite, and which ones are we going to import? Because a typeface is any one as an entire family, but each of those is generally going to be a single alphabet or a single thing to import. So if you think of, if we go back to the concept of the printing press, right? Each size and each weight had a different box of physical metal pieces, right? If you wanted something to be bold, you had to go find the box of bold for that size. Sizing we can do programmatically, but when it comes to whether it's italics or whether it's bold or whether it's regular or thin or in the levels in between, all of those are still individually created sets of alphabets. An italics, for example, is not simply skewing the font bloop and calling it italics. Some typefaces do that, but generally speaking, some of the letters will differ. If you look at railway specifically, like the F is very different in italics than it is in the regular font. So those are different things. So we have to import what we're going to use. So importing everything is generally not your best bet, because you're really realistically not going to be using everything, and it's going to be extra weight on the frontward load. So you're pretty much going to have to say, okay, I want my headings this way, I want my body this way. We're going to go ahead and pick and choose the ones we actually need. Keeping in mind that anything in light under a 300, so as you can see, there's some numbering here, that's the font weight, is going to tend to be quite difficult to read, especially on lower resolution or lower quality screens. So you probably want to shy away from going the extra, extra light, unless it's a typeface that's fairly thick to begin with. The place I generally go is Google Fonts. And the reason being is that fonts, just like most things out in the world, actually do have copyright and have licensing and all of that fun stuff. And so, this is the web. There are such things as viruses out there and pirated copies out there. That's the thing. So I know that when I get it there, I know my licensing is going to be fine. And I know that I'm not going to be downloading some kind of malware of some sort. The other thing it has, which I really like, is that it allows me to choose the category and the number of styles when I'm looking through options that I want. Because remember, over here we talked about alphabets having, you know, each weight in each weight, and whether it's normal, regular, or italics, has its own alphabet. Not all typefaces have been designed to have all of them. A lot of your display fonts are only going to have one version, and you're done. So you can't technically bold it. We'll go over the fact that you can fake an italics, but you can't bold it. You can't do anything like that with it. So you're generally, especially for your large bodies of text, going to pick something that at least has itself a bold and an italics, right? To give yourself some options. So once you've picked what you want, you can go ahead and set your levels, and it'll give you the import URL and all that fun stuff, which is nice. The other nice thing about importing it directly from there is, like, for example, Angular, if you're using Material, comes default with Roboto. That means, like, there are a significant number of websites out there that are using Roboto. So the likelihood of your user having it cached is pretty high. And they also import it from there because, you know, Angular, Google, the whole ecosystem. So that's the other nice bit, is that more than likely they already have that cached at some point. If it's something very common, if it's something a little bit more decorative, not as common, probably not, but there's at least the off chance. So once we've set that in, we can go ahead and determine, okay, what weight do we want in our title? So I've gone ahead and used the first paragraph of Beowulf here in our example, or the first part of Beowulf. And I've gone ahead and my different headings, I've gone ahead and give them different weights. So there's a couple ways we can do weights. We can do it by keyword or by keyword values, or we can do it numerically. So your keywords are going to be normal, bold, which are the ones most people know. And then there's bolder and light and lighter, which you can totally use. Or you can go at it via numbers, with 400 being what is considered normal and 700 being generally what's considered bold. So those are kind of your different ways of going about setting a font weight. Both work. They're both perfectly fine. But that is for your font weights. I have the same slide twice. That's brilliant. Okay. Oh no, that's the lighter one. So yeah, bolder versus lighter. Yeah. Okay. So like I said, italics is not just taking a font and switching it at an incline. Italics versus oblique is where you're going to get that difference. So an italic font is literally a different set of type. It's a completely different alphabet. It's going to look very, very similar than the original, but it is different. Oblique is literally you take the thing and you skew it. So it's going to be taking your normal font and giving it an angle and making it angled. So both of them are going to be under font style. You can pick italics or oblique. But there's a thing about that one. So when you do an oblique, you can give it a degree. So you can make it really, really oblique, or you can just make it a little bit oblique. But if that font has an italics and you have it loaded, oblique won't work and it'll automatically load the italics and it'll completely ignore the degree. Same goes the other way around if you're using italics. So basically you can't oblique something if you have an italics loaded. It's kind of the fallback for your italics, if you will. Does that make sense? So that's the thing about oblique. So if you don't have an italics, you can fake it, but you can't oblique something if you have an italics loaded, which means that some of that very last line, yes, it's completely unreadable, but you know, if you want to do those fun kind of things, you can't load an italics. The other fun things is we often see box shadows. We can do text shadows. So those are kind of fun. They can give depth to something. They have the downside of being quite difficult to read. So it works instead of box shadow, since it's on text, it's text shadow. And it uses the same syntax as box shadow, with your first number being your X offset, your second number being your Y offset, then your blur radius, and then whatever color you want it to be. Those are kind of fun. I wouldn't recommend putting that on a paragraph of text ever, but like for a title, they can add a little bit of extra spice. So we have our text. We've picked out our typeface. We've done some fancy things with our header. Now we can look a little bit about what are we going to do with our lines. We can, earlier I mentioned that we very often when we were in high school and college, if you were in America, that you had the whole write the essay in 12-point font with a double spaced. Well, we can do that spacing in CSS. The term for that spacing is called letting, and it comes from the good old printing press where they would literally take bars of lead and put them in between the lines of characters in order to space them out. We in CSS call that line height, and it takes a number. You can put either a number, you can put the keyword value normal, you can put a number, or you can put a definite value size. So you can put M, rems, pixels, percentages, etc. The problem with doing a line height with a set value, such as pixels, rems, ms, and so on, is that if the font is ever increased and the line height is not increased accordingly, you get text that overlaps itself, right? Because it's a fixed value. If you do not put a unit, then it's relative to the text size by default, and it'll go ahead and scale accordingly as you scale your text. So if you're going to use a unit, make sure that you're scaling it appropriately to your text size. Otherwise, don't use a unit and let CSS do the work for you and it'll be great. A kind of an accessibility tidbit, the kind of minimum value you wanna use for big bodies of text is 1.5 for your line height. That means 1.5 times. Because otherwise it's very scrunched together and it's gonna be hard to read. But the opposite is also true. Don't go overboard on your line height because then there's so much white space between your lines that finding that continuity in your paragraph is just as hard. So keep that in mind with those as you're creating. So with a lot of things, you'll hear me say, beware accessibility. And it's kind of, you're having to think about those things as you're messing with your text to keep that legibility. Because the whole point is for people to be able to read it, right? So yes, let's do cool stuff, but let's not do it at the detriment of our users being able to read what's there. So we can do line height and we can do font size. So as you can see here, I did not put a line height difference. So we had our text before where I said, hey, I want my line height to be 1.75 em here at the very top for our paragraph. And as we can see, they got jumbled together. Now in this case, we have 1.75. And so because I did not put a unit, it automatically accounted for my text size being significantly larger. The other thing we can do to kind of play with making things bigger and smaller are drop caps. We see them a lot in manuscripts, are that very first beautifully embellished letters that you see at the beginning of text. Obviously, we're not going to be embellishing it, but we can actually change the look and feel of the first letter. We do have a selector for that in CSS. And just like we have first child or first type, we have first letter. Unfortunately, that's the for letters, that's the only one that they have. There isn't like, you can't do so it'd be first of type. So first letter of, or you can't do like nth of letter or and give a value or last letter. Those don't actually exist. The only one that exists is first letter. So of a paragraph, you can go ahead and say, I want the first letter of my paragraph to do something different. In this case, I went ahead and gave it not only a different family, but I also gave it a size. I wanted it so many percent larger than the rest of my text. I had to kind of readjust where it was and I had to float it. And the reason I had to float it, is because otherwise it's gonna take up this whole entire space and the second line is gonna find itself under, right? It's just a much bigger first letter. Great. I don't need for, you know, that's not very helpful. So in order for it to fit nicely inside my text, I had to go ahead and float my letter so that the text would come and find itself very nicely beside it. Very similar to when you float a picture, essentially. The other thing we have is first line. So the same way we have first letter, we have first line. So we can do something. So based on your reflow, it will literally affect just the first line of whatever that paragraph or div or whatever you put it on. In this case, I did it on paragraph. And you can do whatever you want with it. You can, in this case, I changed the color and the font weight, but you can change the typeface. You can do whatever you want. Unfortunately, there isn't a first word. So there is nothing word-based and there is nothing, and same as first letter, first line, that's the only one of the series there is. There isn't like last line or anything like that, or nth line do not exist. It's just first line. But it does give you something to work with to begin with. So now that we have a pretty, pretty first line, let's address our links, right? In this particular example, I went ahead and turned all of the names into links so you could go click and figure out who in the world they were talking about, because, you know, if you can't remember who the character is and who's what, then it's kind of difficult to keep track of the story. So I went ahead and linked all of the names. So when we, if you think of links, a lot of times our links are underlined. Where I'm going to show this example on links, but we can do it on any other, you know, you can do it on span, you can do it on div, you can do it on whatever you want. And there's several pieces. We usually do text decoration underline or text decoration none, and that's usually where we stop. But we can actually tailor that a lot more because text decoration actually have, you can choose your type of line, your color, your style, your thickness, and where that line ends up being. Now, I will caution, and I do show that once we're done talking about the individual properties, the support on some of these is very browser specific. So you will get some compatibility issues on some of this between if you're trying to do cross-browser compatibility. So the first thing we can look at is the line. We can choose where that line is going to be. We can say none, which we're used to doing when we don't want that line under our links. We can say overline, which is actually over, which as the name implies, goes over the text. We can do line through, which is how you would cross something out, or we can have the underline, which we're used to seeing. The thing is you can also chain them to literally do all three together should you choose. If you add none in the mix, obviously none's gonna win and they'll all be gone. But you can do overline, underline, and line through on the same as one big chain property and it will totally work. Look really funky, but totally work. You can also choose the type of line. So you can choose solid, which is the default, which was the one we're used to seeing, double line, dotted, the dashed, and the wavy. That famous one we see all the time when we have spelling mistakes. Yeah, that's the one, wavy. That's how you can achieve that one if you're ever trying to roll your own spell check for whatever reason. And then there is the text underline position. And that's the one that has the compatibility issue in terms of browser compatibility. As you can see, it's not ideally, some of the stuff is really not ideally supported. So your mileage may vary, but still fun to play with. And the what the text position does is it allows you to pick auto, which puts it where you're used to seeing, or under, which allows you to say, hey, I actually want it like completely under the word. So if this word had a Y in it, for example, it would be under, instead of crossing through the Y, it would go under the Y. So fun times on the positioning stuff, but it is fun to do, and it's not something that's so different that depending on your use case, you can't put it and it will work in the browsers it does and just put a normal line through on the browsers it doesn't, right? So that's one of those where, it can, you know, it'll pretty gracefully degrade if a browser doesn't have the access to it. So we've got our first line and we've got our, I went ahead and changed to Peter Pan for this example because Beowulf is all cool, but it's a poem and has very different, definite line length. A more standard story that's not poem-like will have, you know, a normal reflow on the lines. And so we went ahead and switched over to Peter Pan, which is just a normal story. And after rereading it, it's probably not the best example because it's really creepy, actually. But anyway, we have you know, some pretty styling on our headers. We've picked our typeface. We've done our drop cap and our first line. And we've got our font. Same thing, I went ahead and made all of our names links. However, now when I expand my page, that makes them for some really long line lengths. And that actually has some legibility problems because, you know, eye tracking, when you're trying to come back to the next line, you go all the way down and then back. If it's too long, the eye has a very hard time following where it should start back up again. And it's really easy to lose your place. So what is that ideal line length? So in print, the cool thing is paper kind of restricts our line length pretty naturally, right? There's only so much, if you're doing a standard printer that's printing an A4 or a standard US letter, it's pretty well definite how wide it's going to get. The interweb, especially with bigger and bigger screens on home computers and on, I know my rig, the screen is pretty damn wide. If I were to try to take that and put it through the entire screen, that wouldn't work. The legibility would be gone. So how do we pick and cap that width? And it's not a definite number, sorry. What we do is we look at the alphabet and the fonts, so the typeface and the size, so the font that we're using. And we type out 1.5 times that alphabet and 2 times that alphabet. So ABC through Z and ABC halfway and ABC through Z twice. And what we have is 39 letters and 54 letters in those two sets. And what we want our width to be is somewhere within this range. So it's not a very broad range, but that is the ideal width for long paragraphs of text.
Can you use M units for that?
There's a better one, actually. Because M is simply looking at the font size, and we'll do that pretty well. But there's a better new unit called CH, which literally looks at the character zero for that alphabet, the number zero, and it looks at the width of that character. And so what happens with the width of that character is it's a pretty average character. It's not super wide like your W, and it's not super narrow like your I. And what you can do is say, okay, I want my max width to be, I picked 54, which is the longer end of CHs. So it will take the relative size that is that. So it will take and count the size, your current font size, and take the size of that zero, whatever that width is, and make that as your max width based on however number of times you decide that to be. So if I had to do, 54 CH would be the width of 54 times zero across the screen. And so that is a very, very nice unit to use for that. M's would work okay. But not quite as well. The only thing to remember with CH is just like M, it's relative to the content size. So if you're trying to use M's for your padding and your margin, which makes for some really beautiful thing because it's very much always, just like M, always proportional to the text inside of it. So it makes for some very nice padding things. It will be relative to whatever the font size in that particular element is. So keep that in mind. You might get some funky, you know, when working with M's, you sometimes get that, why is this so small or why is this so big? You're going to have the same issues with CH if you're not careful as to what that the font size for that particular element is going to be. So we can put a max width. I also add a margin of zero auto. That way it nicely centers it. And we're really nice. Another unit I want to point out is EX, which is the X height. So if we have a letter, I'm going to use this capital, this word, we're going to use something a little bit more readable here. The number 2 right here, or the word 2 right here, the X height would be from the bottom of the W to the top of the W. And that is something if you're looking for a vertical space proportional to your text. It's looking at essentially the X height is, give or take, is pretty much the size of a lowercase letter where that does not have an ascender or descender. basically. So that's a really nice one to use for your vertical space. So a lot of times for my padding, I'll use around my stuff, I'll use, you know, 2CH on the left and right and 2EX on the top and bottom. And that means it's nice and relative to my text and makes for some really nice percentages. So we have, so this is what it would look like on this, the shorter edge versus the longer end of the spectrum for shorter line with 39, which is kind of, it's our 1.5 alphabet versus our 54 CH, which is 2 alphabets. So that's nice and readable, especially compared to that first image I showed where it was all the way across the street, right? So now we have something really nice. We can also do columns, and columns are really cool. And this is not grid. Let me make this super clear. This is not grid. Because what it does is it automatically takes in context the actual reflow of the text itself. Grid looks at the container. These columns it's looking at, and the terminology is very, very similar. So it's easy to think, oh, she's talking about grid. Nope, this is not grid. And what this will do is you set a column width, or you can set a number of columns, and it will look at the available space on the screen and go ahead and take the content and make it into columns. If you have, if you had a span or something in there, it would, you know, take the normal reflow of what's in that container and go ahead and put it into columns. The downside to that, at least on screen, is that it, so if you tell it you want a column width of 39CH, which is, you know, based on our, in that case, based on our 1.5 alphabet over here, right? It's super cool. It's going to take your entire column, it knows it has enough room for two columns at that width. Cool, it's gonna make two columns. And then it's gonna put your entire content into two columns, which means that in order to read the text, I need to read, scroll, get to the bottom, come back up here, scroll back to the top, come back up here, scroll all the way to the bottom. Not ideal. If I say, okay, fine, I'll cap my height, I'm going to make my columns so that the container is so that you don't have enough room. I'm going to bank on the overflow and go sideways. Now I have sideways scroll. Not ideal. So why am I presenting this? Since it's really not ideal for screen. It's really cool for things like short lists. If you have like maybe a list of like half a dozen, say you're making a website regarding, I don't know, your portfolio, your skills, right? You got a couple dozen things. It makes for making a nice list that you know is going to be, you know, you're going to have things in the order you ask it to be without having to worry, okay, I have so many skills. I want three columns. I need to break it up into groups. It'll do the math for you. It's great. So it's nice for those kind of things, but for long bodies of text, not ideal because of this whole, like where you're going to put your scroll. However, for print, it's glorious. Because it does actually understand where the end of the page is. So as much as it did the whole, I got to scroll all the way to the bottom and then come back up to the top to read my second column, in print, it won't do that. It'll put it all the way to the end of the page, go back to the top of the page for your second column, and then continue on the second page and third page. So it's actually properly done as you would expect columns to work in a standard book. So for making really nice print layouts, you can use the AppPrint media and go ahead and set yourself up to have some really nice columns in a print layout, even though on screen, other than for really small use cases, such as small lists or whatever, it's not ideal. So in this particular case, I told it, hey, on my paper, when you print, I want my column count to be 2. I want you to create 2 columns. So no matter how big or small the paper it gets printed on, it's going to give me 2 columns. I could have picked column width instead. And then I'm going to tell it I want a column gap of 2 rems. So I want, you know, a gap between my 2 columns here to be 2 rems. If you do not give it a column gap, these two would like butt up against each other. Readability, not ideal. So you want to make sure you got that column gap. But it makes for some very pretty print layouts. So that's why that one's important. Text indent, that is exactly what it sounds like. So in this particular case, we use text indent sometimes for things like block quote, for example. In this case, I'm gonna say, hey, I want every time I have a paragraph, that's not the first paragraph because we did a pretty drop cap on the first paragraph. I don't wanna mess with that. I'm gonna want you to indent the first line, super simple. And that takes, you can do Any kind of fixed or relative values, not a problem. You can't, they are starting to have some experimental things with each line and hanging, but most of them are behind flags and you have to either turn them on in your browser or they will or will not work depending on the version of which browser you're using. So beware, they're kind of playing with it. We'll see what comes out of it, but right now still very experimental, kind of fun to play with, but production, I wouldn't recommend. So now that we have figured out kind of our paragraphs, how wide we're gonna make it, what our lines are gonna look like, what our print's gonna look like, we can also look at how we're gonna structure that paragraph. Right now it's by default. As you can see, we have a jagged edge over here. If we can follow what the words are doing, we can have a jagged edge. We have a couple options we can do to justify our text. We can do left, center, or left, center, left, justify, or right. So the advantage of that for justify is you get these nice column tables, just like you see in the newspaper or things like that, those nice, beautiful columns. The downside is anything that's not left justify is harder to read because you're now messing with the spacing between the words in order to achieve that effect of where you're going to put it. If you're going for right justify, you've got that whole, I'm reading. Sure, I always end in the same spot, but I don't start in the same spot. So now you're having to hunt for where the line starts every time. That's the same problem you have with center. Outside of like titles and small things, I would never justify an entire paragraph that's center because you're having to find, you know, visually find, and yes, we're talking nanoseconds every time, but if you're looking at, you know, a 500 page book, those nanoseconds add up and it means more drain and it becomes more tiring for your reader. So you can do some cool effects on that for shorter paragraphs and for very specific things, not so much for large bodies of text, would not recommend. The other thing, and so with the spacing, once you start messing with spacing, if you have a poorly kerned type and a poorly put together type, what you will see in there called rivers, is essentially you'll end up with these weird white space pieces that go down your screen. And it literally looks like there's a river of white going down the screen across the text. So if you take a poorly designed font or a font where somebody's, you know, messed around with the spacing of the words and the letters too much, you're gonna get what's called rivers. And those make it very, very difficult for the user to read and makes it hard to differentiate, is this truly one paragraph, or are they, if they're really, really bad, you know, are they trying to get fancy with some design in there or whatever? Like there's a whole slew of issues with that. So be aware of those, they can happen. So I mentioned the word kerning a couple times. Kerning, so we have the word spacing, right? Which is the spacing between our words. Kerning is the spacing between our letters. So if we think of a letter takes up a certain amount of space by default. If you think of the, like a metal type for each of your letters, for those who have children, I don't know if you've seen recently, I saw some stamps where literally each stamp was a letter of the alphabet. Very similar concept. Each letter has its own space it takes. But then what we can do is we can kern its letter so that there's essentially a little bit of overlap. You see this L, for example, there's plenty of this room for the O to kind of shove itself into the L space to kind of make it more visually pleasing. Couple years back, the Google logo, for example, was not kerned. So literally every letter kind of did its thing. And recently they moved it in so that the letters fit better together. It was a minute change, but it makes all the difference in terms of how visually pleasing it is. We can actually mess with the kerning of our letters with CSS. So like everything else, messing with their kerning means also potentially breaking our readability. So with caution and not to excess, but we can totally mess with our kerning. It's letter spacing in CSS. And so what we can do is literally tell it, hey, in between each letter, I want you to put an X amount of space. So in this case, I said, hey, so remember CH, that value that I talked about earlier, I said, between each letters, I want you to put half of a CH in between each of them. So it spaces out the letters, which visually is cool. And it's kind of fun for like this one singular thing at the bottom. But if you tried to read an entire paragraph written that way, that would be a major pain in the butt. And you get tired really quickly of that. But you can actually mess with it. The downside is, because we have no way of selecting other than the first letter, we have no way of selecting individual letters. Once you set a kerning, you're setting it for everything in that, whatever that element is, right? You can't just say, short of putting a span or some kind of something in there to be an element, you're doing every letter in the element. So you don't have, like with Illustrator, I can decide to kern every letter slightly differently to make it, you know, do exactly what I want to do. With CSS, you're going to have to, you're basically going element by element, unless you're using first letter, which is fine. But so font variants, we picked a font, right? But we can actually tailor how we want that font to look. There's a couple things there's ligatures that we can mess with, and there's numbers that we can mess with. Those are the ones I'm really going to focus on. Obviously, I am currently residing in America, and I do not know, the only languages I know are Latin-based languages with Latin letters. So I'm not going to speak to the last two, which are specifically related to non-Latin languages. Or non-Latin letters, but we're going to focus on ligatures and numbers really quick. So what are ligatures? Ligatures are essentially, it's an extra character. It's legitimately an extra character in and of itself that you're going to use in the place of two letters when those two letters look nice together. So the most common letters to join together into a new character per se are going to be F, so FF, FL, FI, FFI, and FFL because of their shapes. So in this particular case, this is railway. And what they've done is you can see that the F and the L have literally been smooshed together like in this one in order to essentially create a new character because the L alone does not have its bump on top and the F alone, like in this guy, doesn't quite go as far. So you're literally creating a new type with combination of letters to give your typeface extra spice and extra flair. So you can decide whether or not you want the font to actually use those alternate characters or not. They're prettier, but for things like young readers maybe that are still learning their alphabets, writing a website to teach first graders how to read, throwing ligatures in the mix, probably not the best idea. So keep in mind your audience and those sorts of things. If you're writing this super cool, awesome resume and you want it to be gorgeously pretty on your portfolio piece, go for it. You know, it's pick your poison. The other piece that we can use when we're looking at is numbers. There's two types of numbers. And when we're looking at typefaces, there is the old style and the modern figures. So the old style figures do not actually follow. So if this is the baseline, and this is our X height. It doesn't follow, you know, they bleed above and below. A modern figure stays all of them the same. So if you're doing something related to accounting or that's very number heavy, going for something that, and you want your numbers to line up prettily, you're probably gonna go for a modern figure. If numbers aren't a big deal and you're looking for something with more flair, then you're probably gonna want something with old style. And so what you can do is for this particular, this is still under all in font variant. I can say in my font variant, I want to align my numbers. So aligning, and I want small caps because small caps is also part of font variant, which is basically you're doing all your letters look like capital letters, except the small version of it, except if it's capital, in which case it's a capital. So what I've done over here is that, hey, before each of my chapters, I've created a counter instead of creating a list. I don't know why I created a counter, but I created a counter probably to show that as an option for CSS. And I did li. So before each of my paragraph chapters, I went ahead and say, hey, I want you to go ahead and put a counter and I want you to put the number in the word chapter. So that's chapter counter. I gave it a font size. And I told it, I want you to align my numbers. So over here, you can see I have the I have an old style number. So our three, it's a little bit hard to see, but our three actually dips below our baseline, or our six dips above our baseline. In this case, they're all neatly aligned with the baseline so that they can align neatly and kind of visually follow our underline if we want to. This is a lot more relevant, again, when doing math. Generally speaking, your having lining up your numbers is going to be a lot more, a lot nicer when you're doing math. So there's the alignment. The other thing you can do with text transform is capitalize. I like doing putting that property on my titles for consistency, for example. That way I know that every word, so it's not going to give you a true title case. It's not smart enough to go ahead and say, oh, this is an and, I'm not going to capitalize it. And this is a, you know, this is an actual long word, I'm going to important word, I'm going to capitalize it. It's just going to capitalize every word, which is nice because it gives you the consistency. So if we see the home under the ground, if I set it to capitalize, it's gonna, if I set it to text transform capitalize, it will actually capitalize the U and the T. So over here, it's capitalized C, it's got the U and the T. It's not smart enough to differentiate, but it will give you consistency across your application if you want that. The other thing you can do is uppercase and lowercase, which is nice, full width, and then full size kana, which again has to do with more of the Asian languages. That you not have Latin letters. And lastly, I talked a couple times about floating. And so floating isn't, I know float has fallen out of favor. And I know everybody hates float. I know, I've cursed out float so many times too, but it's still really important. You can do your drop caps with it, and you can do some really cool things with images as well. Which you do get with text a lot if you're trying to do like in a blog post, for example, instead of just taking your images, you know, having your text, sticking your image, having your text, if you want to kind of make it more cohesive and go into your text, you're going to use float. The cool thing with float is clearfix and br tag clear both and table after and all of those fun things we used to do is no longer needed. We now can do a display float. Now I'm going to blank on the name. There's a display property specific that does that for us now. It is display flow route, and it will clear your float after it's done. So no more having to do a clear fix and group and BR clearer and all of those fun things. You can do display flow route. So it's really cool. So learn float again. It's really helpful. But the last thing I'm going to show, because we're running out of time and because it's could be an entire talk of its own, is you can actually float your images in your text and make your text follow your image. So you can actually make the make your float in a manner that lets it follow a shape. And so that gets into CSS shape, where there's a couple different properties, but it mostly relies on clip path and shape outside for the actual image that you're trying to curve around. But with the combination of just text reflowing normally and float, you can do some really cool effects like that. So, but that is some, you know, that is an entire talk on how to do that for a different day, but I encourage you to look it up. That QR code is the QR code to the GitHub repo that has all of the code and all of the examples I just showed. With all of the CSS, like the complete CSS, because I did a lot of showing you snippets on how to do things. It has the complete CSS of what I just showed. And feel free to follow me on the social medias of all of the things. The one I am most active on is Twitter. And that is what I have for you. And I'll take any questions if you guys have any.
I had a question on ligatures.
Yes.
If I was trying to use the word staff, S-T-A-F-F, and I used F-F ligature, how does that read in in text-to-speech?
Ligatures, generally speaking, because they're part of text, they should be, it's part of the alphabet. It should just be absolutely just fine. Because you're still typing STAFF, the rendering is choosing to render a different character. But when what you're typing on the keyboard and what is programmatically in the word is still STFF.
Thank you.
I was just going to say congratulations on having Martine.dev.
I know, right? So I went when the dot devs came available, like that morning I went and I was like, I'm gonna get this domain, and it was taken. And I like spent 45 minutes cursing whoever took it before me, just to realize that my husband got it for me and was saving it as a surprise.
I've got guy.dev, so I appreciate the single name.dev. That's not a name ever, you know, not everyone gets to do that. So
yep.
I did also want to say this, your slides are beautiful. They look fantastic. And I really appreciated at the beginning the cuneiform, that sort of historical thing. I just thought that was a really nice way to start. So
I like giving a little bit of history, because even if with this one, the history kind of shaped how we deal with some of the namings and some of the concepts that are there. But even in just how many people actually still know the history of why things are done or what certain things are or whatever, there's very little of that in our culture of the tech and web, I guess. Yeah. So I do like including a little bit of that.
And at the end of the evolution was Comic Sans. So.
Yes, Comic Sans.
It's like those logos where they show the chimpanzee slowly evolving to a human, then devolving to whatever social commentary they want to make about people and technology.
The irony about Comic Sans, as much flack as it gets, is it's actually a very well designed font. To make a joke serious, for children, it is great because they find it approachable. And they found that they actually enjoy reading in it more. And it's also found to be easier for people with dyslexia to read. So there's a lot of benefits to Comic Sans. The fact that it got overused probably is like, and it's, you know, kind of bad name, but there's some definite like actual uses of Comic Sans, unlike Papyrus.
It got overused as well. That's its problem.
Yes, but Comic Sans has redeeming properties. I have yet to find a piece of research, and I would love if, you know,
on the Papyrus is just decorative, is what it is.
You know, feel free to give me you know, to tell me that there is redeeming qualities to Papyrus. But
I can't. I wish I could say that I've never used Papyrus, but if
I wish I could say that too, but I can't.
Like if I'm printing out like a handout for Dungeons and Dragons that's supposed to look like an old handwritten scroll, Papyrus is actually a pretty good choice for that. I mean, it's kind of in the name.
Yeah. Yep.
And yep. So I will cheat and do that. I did leave a little comment. I don't know if you saw it or not, but no. When you talk about kerning, I learned a long time ago that when you do kerning badly, it's called kemming. So I thought I'd share that little joke.
A fun little question. What's your favorite font face or family or typeface?
So it depends for what. I really like Helvetica because it's clean and easy to read, or Helvetica New, or yes, I much prefer Helvetica over Arial, and no, they're not the same. I like it's very purpose driven, and it's almost, because we're so used to seeing it everywhere, it's very neutral, right? If I want to make something look clean, look nice, Roboto is very quickly becoming that way, because you see it so much. If I'm looking for the emphasis to be on somewhere else in my design, and I want which typeface I chose to get forgotten, I really like that. I really like Helvetica for that. What you'll see, I use Railway a lot, simply because it has a lot of choices. It also has it has ligatures. It's fairly widely used. So the likelihood of somebody having it cached is pretty high, and it's decently readable. Trying to think of some ones I use a lot, because that will tell you. There's a handful of, display stuffy. It depends on what I'm doing, right? I think I had a couple of them listed at the beginning here. Mount Sarah's pretty nice. It's pretty basic. I think, where did I have them? So like this one I like a lot, the one that does this thing, that's Bell MT, but that one's proprietary. So you, that's not one that you can get, like you can buy it on Linotype, or you can get a license for it, but it's, you're not gonna be able to get it on Google Fonts. Trying to think of what else I use in this presentation. I don't actually remember what the name of this one is. Verdana's not bad. I still like Verdana. It's a little wide, but it has the advantage of being very versatile and is going to work no matter what without an import. Same with Trebuchet. I like it for that. It's going to work without an import. What else do I use a lot?
I just do all my websites with Impact and leave it at that.
Like Wingdings.
I cried a little.
Actually, I like Railway. I use Railway on my websites. It's a clean font, but it has a little bit of interest in it.
Yep.
And so it makes it slightly more interesting. It's got just a little bit of artistry in it, but it's still really clean and easy to read.
Yep.
Do you like A's that are fancy or simple, like bar and C shapes?
I don't care either way. I find this type of A to be a little bit nicer, because if you think of this, and I don't have any scientific base to back this, but if you think of like the P, the D, P, D, G, they all kind of already have that like round and bar, round and bar, round and bar. So it breaks up that whole round and bar. And my guess is it's probably helpful with dyslexia a little bit, but I have no research to back that. But it definitely breaks up the whole, it's a round and a bar. It's a half a round with the bar. It's mostly a round with a bigger bar. It breaks that up a lot. Which
that's how I write my A's, where I did it when I was growing up, and then I started writing it with just the round and bar, and it's kind of been an interesting experience changing. I can't say I have a preference either way, but it's kind of interesting to like think about the difference of how I was writing it.
I grew up in France, so I still, and like you're taught cursive, you're not taught print, you're taught cursive from the get-go. So I still write in cursive, cause I'm significantly faster at it. And I moved in the United States when I was in high school. So by that point, like my handwriting was established. It's like, I'm not going to suddenly change handwriting just because one teacher doesn't like the fact that I write in cursive. Oh, well, suck it up. So it doesn't really come into play, because you're going to do the A with the wink. And that concept, not so much in cursive. Otherwise, it looks like not really a letter. It doesn't flow. It doesn't do, I don't know. It doesn't do the do.
I guess this is a related question to typeface, but like when it comes to like dark color on a white background, I think the general consensus right now is you don't use like pitch black, or like 0000 or whatever, but is there a general indication of how far you should go, you know, within accessibility guidelines, but just like a good frame of reference? You know, a lot of times I ask this because a lot of times, you know, I get colors from other people. I'm just wondering where that decision kind of comes from.
There's as long as you're staying within the accessibility guidelines and not going for pitch black, it becomes a stylistic choice at that point. It literally becomes a design choice as to what you want to do. I use the Google 000.87 a lot. I find it works well, but I don't use it everywhere because sometimes maybe like I've done a couple sets where I wanted even though it was my large body of text, I wanted that gray to not be a pure gray. Maybe I wanted to warm it up some for effect, or maybe I wanted to be a little tinge of blue or a little tinge of some other color in it. Not a lot, like not if somebody looked glanced at it, they'd say it's gray. But for whatever artistic reason, usually, as long as you're staying within those guidelines, there's no reason not to have fun with it.
I think this slide in particular, like that soft gray really works well at that font size, but probably maybe if it was a little like a smaller font size, it might not work.
There's two reasons that it wouldn't work. It's a cursive. Let's start with that.
I mean the non-cursive, the specific design of an alphabet.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't even know. You know what? Let's find out. I don't even know what color it is.
My eyes are bad.
One screenage. It's a custom. It is all the threes. It's 333. So it's not even specifically, well, and to answer the question earlier, because it's Rochester is the cursive. But yeah, so it's just not black. Is realistically the color on that is not black. But it is it does not have any hue in it.
Cool. Well, there aren't any questions on Twitch. We did hit 5 viewers, so that's good. Yeah. I think I'm one of them. But if there aren't any other questions, then I think this is time to say thank you. And for Matthew to ask me the question that he asks me every month. Before we ask that question, again, I would just want to say thank you, Martin. It's fantastic. And I actually learned a lot of little details that's actually the kind of stuff you get out of these sorts of talks there's the theory of fonts and stuff like that. And that's great, but as a developer, sometimes the little you can do that with CSS is really cool too. It's like those little nuggets or little gems, but it's all great, and I appreciate you giving the talk. And I know I'm being like really complimentary tonight, and that's not my intention. It's just it was really good. so thank you. So.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for having me. I really appreciate. Being here, and if you guys like this one, I've got plenty of front end stuff. So if you want, you know, crazy bat crazy things you can do in the front end, just let me know. I'll come back.
Absolutely. Maybe we can actually do it in person next time. I mean, you're just only over in Indianapolis.
as long as my immediate family isn't all vaccinated, we are not doing that. And
well, I was thinking little... like 6 months from now, hopefully.
Oh, yeah, we can talk out. Again in 6 months.
Yeah. But, I didn't mean next week.
I'm like, right now, even in 6 months, it's not for sure because my little one is only 10 and getting a vaccine for him, right now there are none. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Because we've managed to make it this far without anybody getting COVID. I'm not throwing away a year's worth of quarantine to start being reckless now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm just being hopeful for the future is all.
I'm hopeful for this to end as well. Trust me. And my 16-year-old is, I think, about to like blow a fuse if it doesn't end soon. But it is what it is.
So Horshack Test is on Twitch, actually left a comment here. It wasn't really a question, but a comment. It's a good one. He said, thank you. I like the tip about the 5 most important letters. So that was actually a really nice little detail too. I was looking at trying to figure out what word it was when I first saw it.
It's not. It's literally the letters that are most likely to be different in some way. So they're not only the ones you want to use to compare, but if you're trying to figure out what typeface this is, that would be where you would want to start in terms of making comparisons.
It's a good tip.
The most likely. It's not going to be true every time. It's the most likely to be the ones that are the most distinctive.
Well, excellent. Well, I'm going to go ahead and wrap this up. Thanks again, everyone, for attending. Thanks, Martin, for speaking tonight. And Matt, you've got a question for me, right?
I was hoping you'd just go out and remember, but what's coming up next month, guy?
Yeah, that's right. I did remember, actually. I felt like we needed to continue to play the game. Next month, we have Chris Woodruff giving a talk on Electron called Desktop Development for Web Developers. So an Electron talk, which I think would be really cool. I will ask him. I think it'd be really cool to see Electron plus WebAssembly, because Electron's a web app that sort of bundles up and runs on your desktop. That means you can put WebAssembly in it. I think that'd be really nifty. Maybe I will bug Chris and try and get him to change his talk. But he's going to speak in next month on Electron. So I think that'll be cool. I haven't seen an Electron talk in quite a while. And it's still being used by lots of people. Electron is used for Spotify. It's used for Slack. It's used for Discord. And so it's...
Isn't VS Code in Electron as well?
Adam was. I don't think
Adam was. Okay, it was Adam. I knew one of the editors was.
Adam was actually the GitHub editor that was built that led to the creation of Electron. They ended up building technology to build their text editor. And then they released the technology. I think that's the story there. I could be wrong.
I'm not sure. I knew a text editor had been in Electron. I just couldn't remember which one.
Yeah. And well, this is because it was Adam. And then so the means by which they did it, it's like a particle physics joke. That makes a lot of sense. Yeah, I think it was originally called like Electron Shell or something like that. And they decided that was too verbose. But regardless. Now, thanks for everyone for coming tonight. I'm going to go ahead and turn off the stream. The rest of us, we can hang out for as long as we feel like hanging out. And see you later, internets. See you next month. Bye.